Now we have Jose Polo Gomez. He's from the University of Waterloo, and he's going to talk about measuring quantum fields with particle detectors and machine learning. Jose, you have 12 minutes, and 2 minutes before I'll give you a warning. And whenever you're ready, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Carol, for the introduction. We would generalize afternoon, everybody. Today, I wanted to talk about measuring quantum fields with particle detectors and machine learning. This talk is based on the article that Doreen mentioned with Luis Garay and Eduardo Martin Martinez, but mainly on another paper that we just updated on archive in collaboration with Daniel Grimer, Irene Melgarejo Lermas, and also Eduardo. It has major updates, so if, eventually I'll post it later in Slack so in case you want to check it. This is the main, sorry, no. Now my slides are not working. I'm having a problem.
Maybe try to share again. Yeah, stop sharing then share again. That's right.
Yes, I'm sorry about that. I don't know what's happening. Okay, now it's working. So, as I was saying, I don't know, should I start from the beginning or for the sake of the recording or something? Or
yeah, let me introduce you again and then we
thank you very much. And I'm sorry for the recording. I don't know what happened.
It's moving, right? Do you want to try once again?
Thank you.
So the next speaker of this session is Jose Polo Gomez. He's from University of Waterloo. And he's going to talk about measuring quantum fields with particle detectors and machine learning. So Jose, you're going to have 12 minutes and I will give you a warning 2 minutes before. Whenever you're ready, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Carol, for the introduction. This talk is based mainly on the paper that actually Doreen mentioned before with Luis Garay and Eduardo Martin Martinez, but also on a paper that we just updated on our archive with major updates in collaboration with Daniel Grimer, Irene Melgarejo Lermas, and Luis Garay. And Eduardo Martin Martinez as well. Since this is the main topic of this session, let me start with the measurement problem in QFT. We know that we need to be able to describe measurements, and in physics, we do that using measurement theories, which can be either derived fundamentally or prescribed. We know that that the latter is the case of standard quantum mechanics, and the question is now whether we can actually extend this measurement theory to quantum field theory. Since Sorkin's paper, we know that the answer to this question is no, because either no local projection or a local projection, we are going to run into situations in which faster than light signaling is possible. So this leaves QFT with our measurement theory. This problem can be addressed in several ways, but one possible way is to do it using localized non-relativistic quantum probes that can couple to quantum fields, also known as particle detectors. With particle detectors, we can build a measurement scheme in which we let the detector and the field interact, and that way the detector gathers information from the field through the interaction. After the interaction is switched off, we can perform a measurement on the detector, and now we know how to do that because the detector is just a standard quantum mechanical system. Now, a measurement theory based on particle detectors is a proper measurement theory because first, it produces definite values because we are performing a projective measurement on the detector. It is consistent with relativity because both the interaction and the measurement on the detector are at least within the regimes in which the detector model itself is. We also provide an update rule that turns out to be an observer-dependent update that can also be written in terms of an update of the endpoint functions that characterize the state of the field. And finally, it reproduces experiments because detector models have been shown to be good models for like matter interaction and nucleus to neutrinos interaction. So this at least tells us that with particle detectors, we know how to poke the field consistently, but we are left with the question of what exactly are we measuring about the field when we measure the detector? Also, since our probes are local, as any reasonable measurement model should be, we are also left with the question of what happens if we're interested in global features of the QFT? Can we figure those out? Well, at least for the second question, we are lucky enough that quantum fields, when in equilibrium with their environments and the background, store global information locally, but they do it in a scrambled way. This means that there is not a local observable that we can measure and tells us that there is like three holes in spacetime, but at least we know that the spacetime having three or four holes is going to affect the results of our local measurements. This is well understood, and for example, we know that by looking at local measurements, we can tell things about the topology or the boundary conditions of the spacetime, for example. In unscrambling this global information that is stored locally, machine learning is going to be useful, but it is also going to be useful to answer not the first question that I posed, but a modification of that one that is actually more useful. That is, how do we have to measure the detectors in order to be able to figure out some feature that we're interested in about the field? So in order to see how this happens, let me consider a generic situation in which we are interested in a particular feature P of a QFT. Now, in an experiment that in which we want to figure out this feature P of the QFT, we have two main elements, a measurement protocol, M, and a data analysis function. The measurement protocol produces an array of data, and this array of data is then introduced into the data analysis function, which then outputs a result within the set of values that the feature P can take. Note that the data analysis function is going to depend both on the measurement protocol and the feature that we're interested in. Now, when we measure with detectors, it happens that they are so simple and they have only a few degrees of freedom that we can actually perform tomography on them, and we can do that at different times. So in the end, we can extract essentially all the information that the detector gathers from the field using always the same measurement protocol, which is basically a tomography at different times. This is a very simple measurement protocol, but it's also untargeted because, as I said, it's independent of the feature we're interested in. That means that generically, the data analysis function for an arbitrary feature P is gonna be complicated. But in this sense, this is where machine learning can help us, because neural networks are specifically designed to deal with very complicated, highly dimensional nonlinear functions. So what machine learning is doing here is helping us to shift the burden, the complexity of carrying out an experiment from the experimental design to the data analysis, which is then carried out efficiently by the neural network. So this idea can be actually expressed formally in a general framework. And in order to illustrate it, I'm also going to use simultaneously an example that I call remote boundary sensing. So generically, what we have is a quantum field in a 1 plus n dimensional spacetime, which in our example is just a real scalar quantum field in a 1 plus 1 cavity. We also have a particle detector T with a free Hamiltonian, which in our example is a harmonic oscillator with that free Hamiltonian, where QD and PD are the dimensionless quadratures. The particle detector can be linearly coupled to the quantum field in a local way, which involves that interaction Hamiltonian, generically with a switching function chi and a smearing function F. In our example, the detector is placed in one end of the cavity and is coupled to the quantum field using a Gaussian smearing function of width sigma. This finite width in particular means that the detector is only coupled effectively to a limited range of frequencies, which, as we saw yesterday in Nick's talk, means that the cavity can basically be interpreted as being a discrete lattice. And in fact, if we push this approximation a little bit forward, we can even neglect the non-local terms of that interaction and assume that we only have nearest networks interactions. This is an approximation that we can check later that is actually consistent, and we are not messing the model very much. In general, we'll be interested in a target feature P, which in our example is identifying the boundary conditions of the cavity, and each possible value of the target feature can be identified with a label. In our case, we only have two situations, which I call full bound and cut bound. In the full bound, I just have the boundary at the last side of the lattice. And in the cut bound, what happens is that the last side of the lattice is actually not coupled to the second to last. So effectively, the boundary is in the second to last side. And we are going to ask our goal is to distinguish these two situations only using local measurements. So the first ingredient of this framework is the measurement protocol and the data preprocessing. So generically, what we do is that we initialize at each one of our experiments, we initialize the field according to the label that we are measuring at that time. We also initialize the probe in the ground state and couple it to the field at time t0. We perform tomographies, which are going to depend on the field and on the detector model that we're using at different times. And that way we get a matrix of raw data that are associated to the label Y of the sample that we are measuring at that time. Now, if we realize that all the measurements that we are doing for the same time are independent, we can actually compress those data using only the sample means and maybe higher central moments, for example, using only the sample means, sample variances, and sample fork moments. And that way, we get a pair formed by a matrix of compressed data and the label Y of the sample that we are associated with. In our example, What we did was to simulate the experiment. And in that sense, well, we just applied the central limit theorem and we draw the sample means and sample variances from the distributions that you can see in the slide, where mu q and sigma qq are parameters that we get from simulating the evolution, which we did thanks to the discrete cavity approximation using just Gaussian quantum mechanics. And the second ingredient of the general framework is the neural network. The neural network, generically, in our case, is going to be fully connected feed-forward in its architecture, and it's in charge of providing the data analysis function. In order to do that, we use a supervised training, and we do that training with a certain number of samples, which in our example was 15,000. The training method is the standard one, stochastic gradient descent, and we used, in order to train the network, the 75% of the data we had, and we left the 25% left for validation. In our example, we had a classification problem. We had to distinguish between two different possibilities for the boundary. And as a consequence, we used as a construction the relative entropy between the predictions of the neural network and the actual results that we knew were the ones that we should that the neural network should identify. So here are the results of our work in this example. You can see in the blue line that for any coupling time that is greater than zero, the neural network performs better than random guessing, which would be 50% in this case, at distinguishing the two possible boundary conditions. The red line is the light crossing time of the cavity. And now the green line is something that I haven't explained before, but you'll see it's a situation in which we ask the neural network to distinguish between the situation in which the boundary was at the second to last lattice side and a situation in which at first the boundary is at the second to last lattice side, but then we switch it and we activate the bound between the second to last and the last side, so that in the end we have a signal propagating from the last side towards the detector. The fact that the neural network cannot tell apart those two situations until the light crossing time of the cavity means two things. First of all, that with the approximation that we didn't screw up the relativity in our model, so the approximation was good. But second, and more importantly, all the extra information that the neural network is getting, the good performance that we see in the blue line, is coming from the neural network actually unscrambling the information that we get from the local measurements. And it's not coming from some signal that is propagating from the boundary to the detector. This phenomenon, we can call it, 2 minutes, okay, thank you. So this phenomenon, we can call it seeing without light, is well understood. It has been examined in several papers before, as the one, for example, some of them are the ones listed there. But the interesting part about our work in particular is that we actually saw without light. We simulated the experiment and we saw that using a neural network, we could tell things about the boundary using only the local measurements. So with that, these are the messages I would like you to take home. First of all, particle detector models allow us to build a consistent measurement theory for quantum fields. This is something that we have already talked about in the previous talks. Then machine learning helps us figuring out what exactly are we measuring about the quantum field. And moreover, it does it so efficiently that we don't even have to worry about our measurement protocol anymore, and we can always use the same one, which is basically a tomography. This general framework in particular provides a solution to the problem of how to translate measurements made with local probes into global information about the QFT. And we applied this framework to see without light. And also, if you would like to see how we also use this framework to measure the temperature of the field using only local information and to distinguish also the field when it is in a fog state and in a coherent state, you can check the archive paper that I will later post in Slack. And that's everything. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jose, for the nice talk. We have time for a quick question. Does anyone have a question?
With our roadmap.
Well, if no one has questions now, we still have time for questions in the end of the session. And so let's thank Jose.